What we're getting into here in this video is beyond what anybody should be expected to get into. But we're into it. We're into it. So let us start out first by saying that this video is going to get into the area of the disassociated will, which we believe is a split will. It's actually not a split will, it's a disassociated will. So first, we will center into the mood of repentance with the confession that we have a severe, very severe continuity problem. Very severe. And I would add to that, that this disassociated will thing is not to be trifled with. It is not to be trifled with. Without the acceptance that we have a severe continuity problem, you cannot really get into this stuff. The reason why I'm able to is because I've been practicing this continuity problem technique. I don't have a split will problem. I have a continuity problem. A continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The split will problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So we begin the video, and it's going to be a heavy video like all of them, with this confession that my only problem is a very, very, very severe continuity problem. In fact, this continuity problem is so severe, it's the reason why I'm here on Earth. It's the reason why I find myself on this planet, is unacknowledged continuity problem. Continuity problem unacknowledged leads to our birth on this planet. It leads to it. It causes it. It causes it. And we will explain why. So, I don't have a rebirth problem. I have a continuity problem. Okay, I don't have a rebirth problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I or anybody else has, but it's a very severe problem, an exceedingly severe problem. Rebirth problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. Now, the continuity problem, and we have to talk about this because literally it's more important than breathing. Because if we don't acknowledge it, we will find ourselves with this disassociated will situation, which leads us into the most bizarre scenarios possible. One of them is being born on this planet. That is actually a completely bizarre scenario, to be perfectly clear about it. Totally bizarre. And it's just beginning. It's going to get indescribably more bizarre, actually. So by acknowledging that we have a continuity problem, this puts us on the path home, the path of healed perception, the path of realization, the path of the vision of oneness. It puts us right on that path, and then we can look at some stuff before we couldn't even look at. Guaranteed. What I have seen today is so shocking. There's a little fly there. Go away, fly. It's so shocking that without grounding in the continuity problem, there is no way I could have seen this. It is so disconcerting. And I'm not going to get into all the terrible details of it because I want this video to be viewable by everyone. And so we'll keep it on the level of light as much as possible. So, but I'm in a state of just stunned by the issue is so fraught with fear. It seems to be complex and multifaceted. It's not. It's very simple, but it's hard to talk about it in a simple way because we're so afraid. But to put it simply, we think we have a divided will, that our will has been divided. It has not been divided. This is the crux of the whole healing. It's disassociated. We have a disassociated will. A disassociated will. And we think it's split. We think it's split. It's just severely disassociated. Where it's kind of like a U-shaped thing like that, where It's interesting, like the devil's horns signify, you know, the problem, the severe problem we have. That's like a, it's like that. And it's actually one will, but this side and this side are disassociated. What it is that one side of this U, the sort of this U-shaped disassociation is following one, is the will is following one bit of advice, the other is following another bit of advice. So it seems that they must be separate from one another, but they're not. Our will can never be fragmented or separated, but it can, we can engage in the most severe type of disassociation, where one side doesn't know what the other side is doing, at least only on the very deepest level. Beyond, underneath all this disassociation, is there an awareness. But because of the continuity problem, we refuse to look deep enough. And so it seems as if there's separate wills going on, where it's really our, just one, our own will, just one will, is going in two different directions. Now, each pole of this disassociated will has a different belief of how to remedy this situation. The aspect of our will, this disassociated pole of our will, which is following the ego's advice, believes in unification. This presumes that it's a split will, a split, separated will. The ego says we have to unify the will. Okay, and this is what is very prevalent here. Unification, let's unify, let's make it one, let's unify, it's unification. The other pole of our will, which is informed by the Holy Spirit, says let's have the vision of oneness, the vision of oneness. Let's have the vision of oneness. Let's see that it's actually one. Let's see that everything is actually one. All this dissociation is actually not separate. It's dissociation, but there's a way, but we can see it in a non-relative, non-localized way. We can have this vision which heals our delusion that there's been a separation. And it lets the dissociation, kind of the tension of that ease up. Now, what the ego wants is, again, to unify. And its idea is to blend the two poles, to blend them. And this world is the belief in blending. Okay, so those who follow the ego's, who's the egoic aspect of this polarized will, this dissociated will, is stronger. And so they follow the advice of this will. It seems to be stronger than the other pole. And they come to this world thinking they're here to heal this split through blending. So the ego believes that it's possible to blend mutual exclusives, blend truth and lies. And the ego believes that this will result in a higher state, a higher reality, actually, a greater reality than reality as it is. The ego says it's possible to be something greater than that. And when we blend what is separate, the ego thinks this will create a new reality. But the fact is, our will is not separate. It's disassociated. We're in this disassociation. So the ego says, first you have to make it separate. We have to recognize it is separate. But how do we do that? It's impossible. It's a delusion. It's a dangerous delusion. So this whole area of this disassociated will is a very difficult area to look into. Because what you see is that part of your will that has been following the ego's advice is engaged in a very nasty scenario of how to blend the two wills together, of how to heal this so-called split. And so you realize, oh my gosh, part of my will and my mind has been following this egoic blueprint, whereas this other part has been following the Holy Spirit blueprint. And the two are not compatible at all. And it's kind of like you got a good self and a bad self, so to speak. And to see it, it's very shocking, actually. Because the ego's plan is very, very shocking. What it wants to do on this planet to blend the what it thinks are separate wills. So today I was able to get a retrospective of my life on two levels. One, the Holy Spirit level. The second, the egoic level. Each trying to, of course, the ego thinks it's talking to both because it thinks it's two separate wills. And saying, this is how we're going to blend the two wills. The Holy Spirit says, no. The vision of oneness is the answer. It's not two separate wills. It is not two separate wills. There's no need for any blending. So the Holy Spirit has a very different explanation than the ego. So looking at my life, I was able to see, recognize how the ego had very cleverly tried to blend these so-called two wills together through very, clever and deceptive action. And it's my whole life I'm able to see it, like, wow. Answers, a lot of answers have come up for things that didn't seem to be answerable. And again, the ego's plan is a terrible, terrible plan. I don't want to detail it right now. But it thinks that this is the only thing that's effective. You see, it's from its standpoint, it's saying, what is effective? How can we blend two separate wills together that are mutually exclusive? And it follows that purpose, and it thinks that it can do this, or at least it's going to try to do this. Therein lies the problem. Therein lies the problem for sure. And the importance of sidestepping this effort by the ego. Now, the way to sidestep it is right spiritual practice. That is how we do it. That is how we do it. Now, I will show you something here in this backdrop. We have two birds here, you see. One is up in the trees. The other has decided to jump off the tree, as it were, and to test its wings out and to fly. So we are in a situation similar to this situation, this setup here, in that we need to let go into the vision of oneness. We need to glide into it. You see, this bird here is decided to, it's been up in a tree, has decided to glide down to the ground, as it were. Glide down to stability. And the other one is still considering doing that. It hasn't quite, it's sort of looking and saying, well, I'm not sure if I can do that or not. So the spiritual practices are like this bird that is taking off here. This one here. It decided to whoo, and just let the air, ride the air down. And the other one is still looking, say, can I do that? Can I do that? Can I do that? So this is what spiritual practice is all about. We have many practices here. And they focus us on the continuity problem. Once we except we have a continuity problem and begin practicing on it, literally, we do not have to return to this planet. We're finished with this planet after this life is over. But the question is, once we realize that this whole planet is nothing but delay, is nothing but delay, it's just a delaying game here, what do we do with it? Do we just chuck it aside? No. We have the vision of oneness. We see it doesn't really have any use for us in terms of delay anymore. So what do? We just see it all as equally beautiful. We see it all as equally beautiful. This seeing it as equally beautiful is what I'm calling also the vision of non-relative beauty. The vision of non-relative beauty. Non-relative beauty, in that everything looks equally beautiful. Everything looks equally beautiful. So this bird here has decided to go into this spaciousness, okay, into the spaciousness of this non-relative beauty, where everything is equally beautiful. Okay, now, let me bring forward something else. I had this dream, another dream last night, and again a very significant dream. Was up on an elevated side of a mountain, and way down below was this, it was on a golf course, a golf hole, was this green, and I had to hit the driver to the green, and there's someone there with me saying, it's too far, what are you doing, you're trying to reach the green, no, that's too difficult. And I said, well, I gotta give it a try. So I hit the ball, and it flew onto the green, and they're saying, wow, it made the green. I said, yeah, that's great. And the ball's rolling close to the hole. I said, everything's great. And then for some reason, the ball kept on rolling and kept on rolling and kept on rolling. And then it started going down the side of the green, and then it rolled right into a lake. And I said, what in the world is going on here? I said, that is crazy. That is just crazy. And I was very angry at this. I said, I hit a perfect shot. There's no way in the world it should have rolled into the lake. There's something wrong. Something's wrong here. Then I woke up and I started thinking about it. And I said, you know what? The only way to deal with this situation is to make a hole in one. Because I saw that the green was like saucer shaped, an inverted saucer. And no matter what, how the ball lands on that green, it is going to roll off into the lake. It is going to roll off. It's impossible to keep the ball on the green there. And so I said, okay, I figured everything out. Now I understand why life is so difficult. We're all destined to die, we're all destined to fail, but I said, there's one solution to it. You make a hole in one. So I said, okay, my will is that I'm going to make a hole in one. The ball is going to bounce and roll and go right in the hole. I solved the problem. Then the Holy Spirit brought something to my attention. And it was very disturbing. The Holy Spirit says, look, take a closer look at the hole. I said, yeah, I see the flags there, and there's the hole. The Holy Spirit says, no. No, there is no hole. I said, what? And I got it. I said, you know what it is? The flag is stuck in the ground, and they painted a black circle in the grass around the flag stick with a little white liner of lime that they use. And so it looks, when you look at it, you say, there's the hole. I see the hole. There's the black. It was black. That means this goes into the ground. But there isn't any hole there. It's just painted on the surface. So you can't make a hole in one. It's impossible. There's no hole there. And I saw that and I got really mad. I was very upset this morning. Because then I realized that this whole world is a scam. It's a total scam. It's a total scam. It's completely useless. Its only goal is to delay, It's entirely based on the fear of the continuity problem. And what it does is it gets us continuously, here we are, and I said, my God, all the time in this world I've been trying to make a great shot. That never works because it's all a scam. It's all designed to fail. And now I say, okay, I can make a hole in one. In the back of my mind, I've always been saying that maybe I can make a hole in one. Maybe I can make a hole in one. There is no hole there. So you could be hitting golf balls, example, to that green forever, and it would only result in the ball going into the water every single time. You'd never make a hole in one. And this, what does this green symbolize? Life. Birth into this world. You're born into this world. You strive. You end up dead. You end up feeling like I failed. For some reason, I failed. And so you see, you come back and you say, okay, I'm going to make a hole in one this time. I'm not going to fail. You fail again. And finally, you realize there's never been a hole there to make a hole in one. There's never been anything here in this world to get. It's all simply a wild goose chase. What are we chasing after? Beauty. Beauty. This is, for example, beauty. We're chasing after something to remove this ugly fear that we have within. And so we symbolize out in this world ugliness and beauty. It's called relativism, or duality, dualism, where this something is seen as more beautiful than something else, and then we pursue this more beauty to get away from the something else, which is seen as less beauty, which symbolizes this ugly, is again the fear of an abrupt change of experiencing from what we're experiencing now to experiencing reality, from a dream of death and destruction and separation to a dream to awakening to the complete purity of reality. A dream of severe, complete, inky black darkness to a dream of pure, clear light forever. The abrupt change in experiencing to something that we're not used to, that we can't reference in the past, is what's called the continuity problem. We're afraid we'll lose our identity in such a situation. So we have this dread. We have this dread. And so we delay. We want to delay. We say, I know I don't want to go back home. I want a different solution. So I need to delay going back home. So what we do is we symbolize home by beauty in this world. And we symbolize, so we're pursuing these symbols of beauty. And why do we pursue them? Because we see other stuff that's ugly. And we say, well, that represents my dread, my fear. So I don't want that. I see something over there, it's more beautiful. I'm going to pursue that. And so we literally spend life after life after life after life pursuing, in pursuit of this something beautiful. We call it love, lovely, beauty. I need to find something that's wonderful here and avoid what is not wonderful. That's called relativism, relative beauty. Now, once you see through this whole facade, there's no way to succeed in this world at all. There's no success. It's just a delay. This world is a delaying tactic designed to delay us. Then what do we do with the world? We don't need to go chasing after beauty, do we? We say, but so we could say, well, I just set it all down. I don't need this whole dream anymore at all. I don't need this dissociated will. No, none of it. But then the continuity fear kicks in. So what we do, what the Holy Spirit does for us, is say, look, see non-relative beauty. See everything in the world is equally beautiful. Just one totally beautiful oneness. It's all beautiful. You don't see any. There's something that, like I said, just overlays it. It's like a feeling that overlays everything. Let's say it says just this is all just completely exquisite. So everything is seen as totally beautiful without any difference in this beauty. So you're not driven here and there and motivated, oh my God, I see something more beautiful than that over there. That's ugly. I want to get away from that. Wherever you are in the very heart of beauty. You're surrounded by exquisite beauty. Always have the portable paradise with you. That's how we utilize the world once we've seen through what a scam it is. Okay, we don't throw it in the trash as the ego wants us to do. The ego has a lot of crazy schemes, and the one scheme it doesn't have is the vision of oneness. That's the one, it doesn't have that, which is the only thing that works, actually. So the vision of non-relative beauty, the vision of non-relative loveliness, the vision of oneness, this is how we utilize the world once we've seen that the ego has simply been utilizing it as a delaying tactic. Nothing more than that. See, we think we're getting what we want when we're chasing after beauty. Because beauty, we're symbolizing that, is a stands for what we really want. It's just a arbitrary, we say, okay, that beautiful person, that beautiful place, that stands for what I really want. And this other place, this ugly, terrible place, I want to leave that place. It stands for what I don't want. That stands for the fear that I have. I want to get away from that fear, the ugliness of that dread. I want to get to this beautiful place that stands for the happiness and safety from the fear. And of course, we think that once we get to this beautiful place, we want to stay there forever, so the continuity problem is solved. But it doesn't work that way, because it's not what we really want. It's just a symbol. So we look for something even more beautiful. Which is why you see all these wealthy people, I certainly do, they're never satisfied. They're never satisfied. They always want more. More beauty. And what do they chase after? I'm telling you, their homes are full of beautiful, beautiful things. Things just amazing. This backdrop here, actually, it was thrown away. It was thrown away. I discovered it at the dump. It was thrown away. And there's this beautiful lacquer, you know, hand-carved wood and painted, hand-painted backdrop. And someone said, you know, I want something more beautiful than that. Okay. You see these places and inside of the houses, and the houses are just like, my God, you know, it's like a museum of all this beautiful stuff that they find. And then they find more beautiful stuff and they have to throw away. I talked to the Goodwill people here, and they say, you can't believe all the stuff that people throw away here. And you just can't believe it. So much beautiful stuff. Because there's no room for, they keep getting more beautiful stuff. And so this is our life. This is our life here. This is our lives. And it's all a scam. It's all a scam. Total scam. We're playing on ourselves. Because we think our will is separated, been separated. So we think this is how we can be saved. However, the ego, that part of our dissociated will, the ego is working with that, and it has a different plan for us. And that is the severe issue with the future here. Because we're at a time when we're trying to unify our will. Okay, we're at a time when we're trying to unify our will because we feel that's the only way we can go forward in finding what the beauty we really want. You see, this plan of finding beauty, relative beauty, doesn't work. But the ego has an answer for that. It says it doesn't work because you're not searching in a unified manner. You need to unify your split will, and then you will be able to truly seek and get and own what you really want, more beauty, the true beauty. But the ego says first we have to unify the will. So we're at a stage where we realize, hey, this seeking after beauty, it doesn't work. And now the ego comes in with this plan and saying that's because we need to unify your will. Now remember the beginning of this video, I said our will is not separate, it's not fragmented, it's not split, it's not separate, it's simply there's a dissociation taking place. It's still all one. It's just pursuing two different objectives. But it's not split. So it can't be unified. The ego says, yes, this is the answer. So it's bringing its plan in. And it's bringing the two plans, aspects, trying to bring them together. Which means it's bringing in the ego side of things to blend in with what it thinks is the Holy Spirit side of things. This is the problem with the future here. With the future. This is why people are pointing out to the future saying, wow, look what I'm seeing in the future. Holy cow. Why? Why? Because the ego is bringing in its plan. It's bringing its will, those that have been following its will, and saying, you know, the ego says, okay, time to compromise, time to unify. Okay, I'm willing to blend this. But remember, those who have been following the ego's will are engaged in incredibly unspeakable stuff. So they're here now in this world. They have a plan and they're acting according to that. But the big plan is to somehow unify the two. So it's a chaotic, confusing mess, actually. Now the Holy Spirit has always said sidestep the situation. Now how to do that, whether that's an actual physical sidestepping or not, I don't know yet at this point. But what's ultimately the way is to do the spiritual practices. That is the way. Is to see that the will doesn't need to be unified. That we need just to ease the dissociation. A gentle easing off, a gentle backing off the dissociation is what does it. And what does that is right spiritual practice and ultimately the vision of oneness, the vision of non-relative beauty. Non-relative beauty. Everything has this equal loveliness to it. It's a common quality to everything. Everything, you see, everything has this common quality to it. And I'm just anticipating that, and I'm just feeling this tremendous relief. Like, this is what I really want to see, for sure. That enables we back off our dissociation of our will. And so then we begin to realize our will is one. It's always been one, which is very essential before we accept reality as it is, because we couldn't function in reality with a dissociated will. Our will is always one, and our will is what we use to experience and to function as we were created to function. So with this dissociated will, we feel like we can't even function properly in reality. So we're afraid to go back. And they say, how would I function there? I can't function there. So first this dissociation needs to be eased up. And this vision of non-relative beauty eases it up for us. It eases it up for us. So everything we see has this common denominator of this loveliness. It's like everything is touched by the same loveliness, by the same exquisite beauty. This is the vision of oneness, the vision of non-relative beauty. And automatically, we say, oh my God, there is just one will. You know, I see this one will is touching everything with this beauty. I don't need to try and blend separate wills, or I don't need to go along with the ego's plan at all. So, we have the right clarification at this point to deal with the situation that's coming. It's only a matter of using our will to actually practice. And listening too is a form of practice. It is a form of practice. It's hearing it and remaining in the mood of repentance. I'm still shocked from the day of seeing what I've seen, for sure. But I seem to be handling it okay. I'm still able to, you know, focus, and it's not easy to deliver this video, that is for sure. But doable. So, let me get into it. If we can practice a little bit. The practices don't have to be some kind of ego says, well, you gotta, if it's such a big problem, you gotta practice perfectly. No, who's the ego to give us advice on that? We're doing a gentle soft landing. If we practice perfectly, it might be a hard landing, right? Immediate. So we are, it's okay to simply try. It's okay to simply try. That's all you have to see. The ego stops us by saying, wait a minute, you're not perfect. Imagine if you were a piano student and the teacher said, you know, you have to play this song perfectly, exquisitely, without flawlessly the very first time you try. Otherwise, I'm dismissing you as my student. What kind of teacher is that? Look, that's the ego. That's the ego. The Holy Spirit says, look, this stuff is quite, you have a problem with your will. You feel it split, and even though it's not, but it is dissociated. You have a severe continuity problem. And so your playing is going to be hesitant and stumbling, which is fine. But as you continue practicing and playing, you'll get more and more confident. You'll start smoothing it out. That, of course, that's how you go about it. So Holy Spirit is not some crazy teacher trying to dismiss us if we don't do things flawlessly. So we can talk about this beauty. I haven't done a list of this beauty. I probably could do that. It is the flawless. It is the flawless. It is the unswitchable. Unswitchable is unswitchable. You can't switch it to something else. You can't switch it to something else. I'm just thinking, how do we go about this? Well, let's ask the Holy Spirit here. Let's catch our breath first, because we've just gone over some very heavy, heavy, heavy information. And I did avoid getting into specifics about the future and the ego's plan of what exactly it's going to do, but I certainly have seen more of that today, and I don't want to talk about it in this video. The vision of loveliness, the vision of non-relative loveliness, touching everything. This plant, this tree as it is, is touched by the beauty that touches this bird in the tree, which touches this bird in the air there, which touches this palm leaf, which touches this couch. This beauty which touches this couch is the same one beauty which touches this bird, which is the same one beauty which touches this bird, which is the same one beauty, same non-relative beauty that touches this tree, which is the same immutable, wide open, supremely lovely beauty which touches this moment, which is the same which is the same immutable, infallible, effulgent, smooth, changeless, locationless, supremely authentic loveliness that touches this day, which is the same unborn, core, authentic, unelaborated, immaculate loveliness that touches this planet as it is, which is the same peaceful, blissful, all-inclusive, perfectly compassionate, totally balanced, radiant, nurturing, affectionate, caring, inseparable, transparent, changeless, residue-free, all-embracing beauty that touches this universe as it is. Which is the same non-reflected, non-pulsating, non-alternating, non-waveform, non-particle-based, immeasurable, non-technical, data-free, sourceless, ungenerated, non-intensed, smooth, calm, blissful, tranquil, still beauty that touches this room, that touches all of this room, all of this room, all of this room. It is the welcoming, it is the same, which is the same welcoming, fresh, connective, healing, non-fabricated, non-defined, groundless, non-concretized, beautifully blissful, simple, relaxed, pure, core treasure of certainty and love and purity of the wordless loveliness, the wordless loveliness, the wordless loveliness that touches that stone, that touches that stone, which is the same peaceful, divine, boundless, incorruptible, holy, holy, holy loveliness that touches that tree as it is, that touches that tree just as it is. One moment. Which is the same non-reflected, non-fadable, immutable, ultimate, total, uncongealed, non-crystallizing, unalloyed, untransmittable, never-ending, never-absent, non-dimmable, all-pervasive, formless singularity of pure space, of pure silent spacious beauty that rests upon this dirt as it is, that rests upon this dirt as it is. So we are now practicing. We are like this bird that has decided to practice. Okay, there's a bird. So we're no longer the bird in the tree. Which is the same, the very same sourceless, impersonal, all-merciful, non-intense, directionless, all-embracing, process-free, non-defined, non-localized, traceless, and baseless, blissful, glorious, and serene, graceful, smooth beauty. Graceful, smooth beauty that touches that wall, which touches that wall as it is, just as it is, that wall just as it is. The graceful, smooth beauty that touches that wall as it is, which is the same, free and centered and assured and present and compassionate and non-obscured and ungenerated and beautifully diffuse and welcoming and relieving and fresh and calm and silent, timeless beauty that touches that flower and rests upon that flower right now as it is. That rests upon that flower as it is. It's which is the same, the same, the same, the same light, the same seamless light, the same heart freshness, the same inclusive calmness, the same all good, supreme authenticness, the same non-concretized, all-pervasive spaced outness, the same wide open naturalness, the same all good, effulgent, ungenerated, peaceful, blissful beauty. The ungenerated, peaceful, blissful beauty that rests upon that car as it is, that rests upon that car as it is, which is the same eternal, formless, secure, incorruptible, sweet, sweet, sweet loveliness that rests upon that road as it is, that rests upon that road as it is. Okay, so all we're doing here is we're like this bird. We've decided, let me just sort of glide out of the tree. We're just gliding out of the tree. It's easy. Just open your wings and glide. Just open your wings and glide. That's all. We're just gliding. We're just gliding on the air. It's no big effort on our part. So, it is the same. It is the same core. It is the same core grace and assured divinity and the non-congealing, non-hoardable, sourceless, non-technical, free, silent spaciousness, the unattached oneness of wordless beyondness, of the pure, graceful presence of total beauty, which rests upon that house just as it is. It rests upon that house as it is, which is the same, all forgiving, all grateful, all compassionate, all kind, all merciful, all understanding, all supporting, never fading, never eroding, incorruptible, immutable, immaculate loveliness that rests upon this sky as it is. Which is the same, identical, intangible, mindless, uncontrived, undifferentiated, all-pervading, immutable, unborn, authentic, smooth, pure-centered, eternal life vision. Eternal life vision of intrinsic beauty that rests upon this world, that touches this world as it is, this instant, just as it is, rests upon the world as it is, which is the same, effulgent, non-reflected, thought-free, impersonal, ever steady, non-energetic, gentle, calm, easy, relaxed, miraculous treasure of loveliness. This miraculous, relaxed, miraculous treasure of loveliness, which rests upon and touches the entire universe just as it is. Just as it is. It is the glorious loveliness that touches everything just as it is. It is the peaceful beauty which rests upon everything just as it is. It is the wide open purity of loveliness. It is wide open purity loveliness, wide open pure loveliness, wide open pure loveliness that touches this air and rests upon this air just as it is. It is the effortless, seamless, boundless, wordless, formless, still, serene beauty that rests upon all vegetation just as it is. That rests upon all vegetation just as it is. It is the non-other. It is the one without a second. It is the immutable and inseparable, supremely all good, clear, transparent loveliness that rests upon all water as it is. It rests upon all waters as it is. It is the unborn, unceasing, non-congealing, total, ultimate, intrinsic, groundless, residue-free, effulgent, serene, glorious beauty. The glorious beauty which rests upon everyone. Everyone's spirit. Just as it is. It rests upon everyone's spirit here, just as it is. It rests upon everyone's will here, just as it is. It rests upon all appearances here, just as it is. It rests upon all forms. It touches all forms, just as it is. All the formless. It is the uneatable lovingness. We can't eat it. It is the undrinkable. We can't drink it. It's the untouchable. We can't touch the beauty, but it touches us. It is unfathomable. It is the unfathomable light of being. It is the non-adjustable. It is the motionless beauty. It is the motionless beauty. It is the non-directional, non-composed, non-aligned, non-arranged, formless beauty that rests upon this day as it is, that rests upon this day as it is. It is the unmeltable beauty. It is the uncompressible beauty. It is the unharvestable beauty. It is the unplantable, non-relative beauty. See, it is the unplantable. It is the unstorable, non-relative beauty. It is the unstorable loveliness. It rests everywhere. Its home is everywhere. It rests in its home, which is everywhere. It simply rests in its home. It's just resting in its home, which is everywhere. So it is the everywhere, omnipresent, fresh, eternal, sweet, ageless, incorruptible, immaculate, carefree, self-assured, compassionate, heart, divine, still, calm, forgiving, beautiful, blissful loveliness. Beautiful, blissful loveliness. It is the beautiful, blissful loveliness that touches this leaf as it is. That touches this leaf as it is. That rests upon this leaf as it is. This loveliness, this non-relative loveliness, rests upon all that I see. This non-relative loveliness rests upon all that I see. It rests upon this is it. This as it is it. This as it is it. This as it is touched by loveliness. 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 This as it is touched by the non-relative beauty. The non-relative beauty. The non-relative beauty. It's not beauty relative to something else, which is less beauty. It is equal beauty. The vision of equal beauty. The vision of equal loveliness. The vision of equal beauty. You wonder, how can they look at something like an ugly concrete building or something and say, oh, that's so beautiful? Because this beauty touches it all. It's overlaid, as it were. The same overlay as it, on that field there, on the sky, on that mountain, on the trees, on the street, on the cars, on the people, on the waters, on the vegetation, on the dirt, on the rocks, on the sky, on the stars, on our thoughts, is the same loveliness touching everything. So you're seeing the loveliness. Let's say everything was gray in the world, and you decided to paint it this beautiful soft yellow. Everything was this glorious, beautiful yellow or soft green or something. And now everything you look at, oh, it's so beautiful, it's so beautiful, it's so beautiful, that's so beautiful. We put paint on our houses because we think it's more beautiful. We dress things up, we think it's more beautiful. Well, what if everything had this, was dressed up in this equal loveliness and beauty that was ever fresh? There was just this freshness to it, this still, serene, calm, new, now, formless, timelessness, non-agingness to it. It was just like, it was so incredibly lovely, exquisitely lovely, and everything was touched by this. Then, whatever you look at, you're seeing that. You're not focusing on what it's overlaying. You're not trying to see that, now you're seeing the loveliness. That's what you really want to see. And that's what you're seeing. So it's not two separate things. It is, you're not trying to unify, okay? You're not trying to unify. But what this does is helps us realize that our will was never separate in the first place, was not split in the first place. Now you say, wait a minute, I got this loveliness and then I got this ugly building. Let's unify the two, let's blend the two. No, that's the ego. That's the ego. Just let the vision be as it is. Don't try to do anything with it. Don't try to do anything with it. Because the ego will say, well, I haven't reached my goal yet. Because now, how do I blend that with my plan of, you know, how do we blend this? No, we're not blending anything. We're just looking at this overlay of everything. We're not trying to blend the overlay with what's being overlaid. So at least we've tried here. At least we've tried. You see, we've tried to, and I will try some more, God willing, to practice, some explanation, some practice. I don't want to make the video too long. And we will continue to be like that bird who's decided to glide into the air, just gliding. Doesn't even have to flap its wings. You know, just glide like a glider, like a glider. This is not an energetic loveliness. We're seeing non-relative loveliness. It's not an energetic loveliness. It's not in motion. It's not going somewhere. It's not flowing somewhere. It's not rushing to, because this loveliness is touching everything equally right now. Where could it be flowing to or going to or trying? It's a non-effort-free. It's not making any effort because it's already resting upon everything. That's its home. Its home is everywhere. So it's not trying to go anywhere. So that assures us to say, wow, it's already resting on everything. Everything in the entire universe, it's already resting on it. Just as it is. Just as it is. It's not waiting for something to change. It's resting on everything just as it is. And that this reminds us of reality. It cures our continuity fears by reminding us of reality. It reminds us of the exquisite, beautiful beauty of reality, the effortless beauty of reality, the effortlessness of it. How it's everything, everywhere has everywhere. Everything has everything. All has all in reality. So it's a gentle reminder of reality. But we're still keeping this world that we made to put us on this wild goose chase, right? Thinking that we had these separate wills and trying to delay because of the continuity fear, we're trying to delay going back home, waking up from this coma, trying to delay it by chasing after relative beauty and thinking, I'm making progress. Just constant, I'm making progress. You look back on your life and say, wait a minute, I've been doing the same stuff my whole life, really. I used to think these pictures were beautiful, or these graphics, now I think these are. I used to think this person was beautiful, now I think this person is. And it goes on and 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 on. Same old thing, same thing. Every life is the same thing. I think this song is beautiful. Now I hear a more beautiful song. I'm continually pursuing this path. And we think we're making progress towards what we really want. We're not. We're not carrying mind. That doesn't remind us of reality. Not at all. Doesn't work. The vision of loveliness rests upon everything equally. We're not leaving anything behind. We're not excluding or rejecting anything. That reminds us of reality. That reminds us of reality. So, let me get this video up so you can at least feel that you're practicing some, and I'll see what I can do going forward, if I can. I'm still trying. But it's shocking times for sure. It is shocking times for sure, because the ego's plan of unification is coming in, you know, to fruition. And you can feel it, can't you? You can feel it. You say, uh-oh, uh-oh, this doesn't feel right. This plan of unification doesn't seem like it's working out. Doesn't seem like it's going to be what I really want. And because we don't feel we have an alternative, because we don't recognize a continuity problem, because we think our will is split, we feel helpless. All we can do is complain about it. Complain. No, we can have this vision of non-relative loveliness, non-relative beauty. That is the alternative. That is the alternative to the ego's plan of unification. And you know that's not going to go the way you want it to go. So let's stay with this. Just a little glide, a little glide, a little practice goes a long way. A little practice goes a long, long way. All right, very great. That's it for this one.